professionals here for opening forum. It's great to see everybody back on campus. I love the energy and really commitment we feel at the start of the semester. It's always that refreshing sense of renewal that we have at the start of the semester. There's that sense of promise and optimism. Our students are so excited. I've had so much fun walking around seeing the students during opening day. I had some wonderful conversations with students at the barbecue. And I had some wonderful conversations over the last couple of days on campus, out in the Multicultural Center, talking to students there, and talking to students in the hallways, and in the elevators. Well, I take the stairs. There are students on the stairs. And it's really easy to enjoy what's going on here. I want to say a warm welcome to the people in Bedford who are down there in the cafeteria, really enjoying it. So let's give the Bedford people a round of applause. It's really nice. We are trying to set this up where we have the video streaming going so they can see us, so we can get more and more people engaged in these conversations at the college. So first of all, I want to thank Chairman Jim Campbell, Chairman of our Board of Trustees, for coming today, and Jim Hicks, long-serving board member. It's great to have him here today. So it's, as I said, it's always easy to tell people in the community that this is a special place and just a wonderful place to work, and seeing the commitment of all of you in the room here and all of our folks in Bedford, it's great to see you today. But today we have a special opportunity to welcome a new member to our community, and it really is my great privilege to introduce Dr. Ref Song, coming up here from Cambodia to be our Fulbright Scholar. So please join me. That's the price you pay here, all right? So MCC has a long connection to the Cambodian community and a direct connection to the American University of Phnom Penh. It's my privilege to have Dr. Ref Song here today. He's an assistant professor of economics at the American University of Phnom Penh. So Dr. Song grew up in a rural area of Takyo province, where he experienced the genocidal regime of the Khmer Rouge during his childhood. He graduated from the Royal University of Phnom Penh and did postgraduate training in journalism, and then he trained at the National Teachers University and did postgraduate training in journalism, but also training as a high school math teacher. He was awarded a Royal Government of Belgium doctoral scholarship and received his doctorate from the University of Antwerp in Belgium in 2009. He was awarded a two-year postdoctorate fellowship and carried out research on the effects of economic globalization on labor markets in Belgium. He is currently an advisor to the Deputy Prime Minister and chairs the Ministry of Education Committee on High School Economics Textbooks. He has published in numerous international journals and is a member of the editorial board of the Journal of Business and Management. He's also, as you get to know him, warm and humble, interested in learning as much as he can, and it really is a privilege to introduce him to you today. We're going to give him an MCC pin. He will be around afterwards, so when we're here afterwards, please come up and introduce yourself and meet this wonderful scholar. Begin today with some of the lessons I've learned about Middlesex Community College over the last 2 years. I was drawn to the education professional because, like all of you, I love to learn. And I've been learning about this college even before I started. So in the months leading up to the interview process, I was digging through the website, learning as much about you, calling anybody I could find who was in the education system in Massachusetts. So it's been really an interesting journey in learning about this school, and I wanted to share a couple of points today. One of the things I found out about this is that people make the place, and this is a place full of great people. You are really dedicated, hardworking, creative, and most of all, willing to take risks. I mean, you look at Steve Rossi and, you know, Ben back there. Were they worried on Tuesday about the weather and whether we still had a tent in Bedford? Sure. I've enjoyed learning about the quirks and the differences that we have in this very diverse community, the diverse thoughts we get, and really, these things come out when you least expect it. And I don't know if anybody's noticed, but there's some really funny people here. I mean, Bert in the mathematics department, who knew that people that serious could crack that many jokes, particularly over lunch? It really is great to see all these people here. And according to Jonathan, I hope he's down there in Bedford, right? Laughter's good for us, right? You know, if our wellness guru tells us this is good, it is good for us. But another thing that's good for us is Genesis Chocolate Supply up on the fifth floor. That's not candy, remember that. That's healthy. So, great people here. But also I see people that step up and get things done when they're needed, no matter what's thrown their way. So I had to write this morning because there were a couple of just great examples from it. So in the last 24 hours, I've seen Provost Sisson and the whole enrollment team step up along with marketing and communications to create some opportunities for ITT Tech students, right? This is no easy matter. These students have had that educational door slammed in their face, right? They've been fed a lot of misinformation. Now they're coming to us. But our team said, we can step up, we can have an open house on Friday, we can have marketing materials ready. We did such a good job that the other two community colleges, they asked to participate, are going, can you guys slow down? You're making us look bad. Right? And again, it's because our people are willing to step up and do a good job. They're stretched pretty thin this time of year, and it's not easy working with students from regionally accredited institutions, but they've shown a real willingness to do the best they can for the students in our community. And late yesterday afternoon, right, we had a car, hit a telephone pole, a power pole just outside the campus on Springs Road. I get a call from Patrick at about 5 o'clock saying we might have to close the campus on the first night. Right? Okay, 5 o'clock yesterday afternoon. All right, so Brian Butler's out there, Steve Hatch is out there, and you know, it turned out they didn't have to turn the power off until 10 p.m. I got an email from Brian at 2:52 a.m. saying power's back on. The computer IT folks did a great job getting everything back up and running this morning. Right? I didn't hear any complaints. I heard we got the job done. That's the type of team we have here at MCC. And as I've said before, this is also a very warm and welcoming place for all who come our way. We have created a safe space here, one that you see very clearly in our multicultural center, in our veteran centers, but also enrollment services, in the libraries, in their classrooms. You have really risen up and shown these students that this is a place where they can safely explore who they are and who they want to be. This is a great place to learn and grow as an individual and as a member of a learning community. So I see people continually reaching out and going out over and above to help the students at this college. And I hear this from people all the time. One of the things that we're doing, two things actually this semester, because we have listened to the needs of our students, is we are opening food pantries and we are opening meditation and reflection spaces on both campuses to serve our students. That's because we listen to the needs of our students. Now, I also continue to discover just how deeply this college is embedded in the communities we serve. I can tell you honestly that people talk to me all the time about how much they value MCC and how strong a reputation we have in this community. When I visit local businesses and organizations, I went to one of the banks here. Every other person either went to the college, or their kids went to the college, or everybody in the family went to the college. I mean, there are those kind of connections here throughout the community. And then we get the former alumni who come back and talk about how this college was really the foundation of a successful life for them. We transform lives here every day, and the community recognizes that. Now, I also get comments that I can sometimes bring back because people will identify the individual. So just recently, I had two parents tell me how much a particular professor had done to save their daughter, and that's the term they used. So it's great when I get to come back to campus and write an email to Jen Bauer and tell her, this is what I hear about you. But I know that we don't hear it all the time, but I know that you are special people who do special things for our students, and I really appreciate that. It makes it an honor to represent all of you in these communities, because I go out there knowing that people have recognized the good work that you've done, and they're willing to share that with me. So I always turn around. Doesn't matter where I am, even when I'm not representing the college, when I'm out riding my bicycle, I tell everybody, oh, I work at Middlesex Community College. And it's just fun to talk about what a great place it is to work and to tell them stories about the good work we do with students. They are always surprised and really in awe at the good work we do every day here. So working here and getting to know the people here, I can also say that we really are a community of professionals. I greatly enjoyed working with leaders like Michael and Reggie, Carlos and Sally, and experienced faculty members like David and Rob and Kathy and Carmen. These people are really special. And working with long-serving staff members like Donna, I heard she's down there, in Bedford, Donna Colella, okay, and Nancy Sullivan, and then you get people like Kathy, and Jackson, all working together to make sure that the finances stay in order. And I see also the people in my office, Laura and Donna, who have developed skills over the years and are so willing to help and always willing to do the job right. We have to always recognize that suggestions and ideas have to be openly explored, and that new ideas are valued no matter where they come from. People know we are all on the same mission and need to recognize that they are all valued members of our team. Now, this is a great place, but we are facing some fairly serious challenges right now. Enrollment has declined for the last 4 years. And our projections are that it's going to decline 9% this year and 7% for the next two succeeding years. So that's more than a 20% enrollment decline over the next 3 years on top of what we've had since it peaked in 2011. We're also seeing declining state support. Our state support has gone down from 49% in 2008 to 38% last year. We're also seeing rising costs for our salaries and particularly fringe benefits, because most of our budget is salary and associated costs. That's more than 85% of our budget. We're also seeing increasing competition out there. I recently heard that UMass Lowell is reaching into their waiting list for the first time in several years. That will ripple all the way through the system. As all the UMass schools are reaching into their waiting list, that's going to impact all the way down through. There's just a huge amount of competition for this declining cohort of students out there. We see the privates bidding very highly for our students, which is good for them, but we're seeing a lot of competition for these students. All of these challenges are leading to significant budget problems, and these will only get worse in the next few years if we don't take significant actions. We've made many reductions, and we've trimmed an awful lot off of the budget. But we've come to the conclusion that we can't solve these problems through trimming, and that we do not want to just ride this down to the bottom. We want to address these challenges openly and honestly and together with you. So, with challenges comes opportunities. And it's an opportunity for us to put our heads together, to rethink our strategies, and to build consensus around solutions while staying focused on our core commitments and our commitment to student success. The opportunities come from the realization that nobody is going to save us and that we need to seize the opportunities and take care of ourselves. As I mentioned, there's a lot of great people here and a lot of great programs. You've done a lot of great work here. I'm going to touch on some of those and talk a bit about where we can take them further. First off, I want to talk about the work that's been done with class scheduling and the recently revamped templates. Those are wonderful steps in building a student-centered schedule. But I think there's more we can do. Last year we ran an experiment with a winter intersession. It drew 600 students. That tells us there's demand there. We now need to look really closely at those alternative scheduling options for shorter class periods. It could be 5-week classes or 8-week classes, late start classes, mini sessions, hybrid courses. We need to explore the successful models that exist out there and really take a close look at what we can do to meet the needs of our communities. We need to talk more about starting the semester right and really engaging with this idea of success from day one. This has the potential to seriously impact our retention because when you look at the data, last in, first out really holds true. It's not a myth. So the revamped opening day is a great start on that. It was all about making connections and really getting the students engaged with it. All of us who worked through those days had a blast with those students, but that's just a few hours, right? And what do we do with the ones who don't show up? We don't have an option because classes start the next day. We need to think through this process of on-time registration, and that's an absolute key to a successful start, so that students are there from the first day, and all of you who teach can teach from day one. We need to work more closely with our financial aid office and to support financial literacy for our students. As we know, students are struggling to pay for college. We've talked before about the myth of working your way through college on minimum wage. You can't do that anymore. How are we going to find the resources for more scholarships, through more fundraising, through more financial aid? How do we find the resources to help our students with these problems? Now, we also need to work on a stronger student portal. College Scheduler is a great first step in that direction. Now, we've really done some leading work with pathways and co-requisite education and these new methods of placement. We have been at the forefront of that and done a great job. But we also need new tools to track and communicate with students as they begin to connect with us. Many people are saying, why don't we do more marketing? Well, I'm not sure we can even follow up on half the leads we get now. We need to have those technology tools in place that will help us really see who's coming to us and what their needs are and how we can help them in real time. So a better portal with tracking and analytics software is going to be a key to being able to intervene in a timely manner with students before we lose them. We talk about the enrollment funnel, it's really a sieve, right? And we really have to work and see how we can do that. you're doing all you can in those enrollment services areas in advisement, but we need to give you better tools. So we also need to be continuing to work on our K through 16 partnerships. We know that the problems in the education system start long before the students ever get here. So I spent this morning in a workshop over at the ICC talking about how can the city of Lowell, working with the public school system, the city, UMass Lowell, and MCC, come together around creating a vision of that education matters in the city, and how do we galvanize the whole city around things like preschool literacy, making sure that every student reads at a proficient level at grade 3. Huge predictor of later success. So we know we can't do anything about that here, but we have to be deeply involved in this community in building those partnerships from the beginning. Do we do anything now? Sure we do. We have TRIO programs, dual enrollment academies, Gear Up, and we work with Project Learn, Lowell Connections program. We have all sorts of connections to the school systems, the community, and the university. We need to think through those more clearly and see what we could do. We know that we are the right place for all kinds of students. And it could be honor students, or it could be the students who didn't ever think they'd make it out of high school. I just heard a story recently where that could be the same person, right? One of our new faculty members, Carlos Mercado, dropped out of high school, right? This is a guy who dropped out of high school. Look at what he's done with his career. By going back to a community college, that's where he started. So this happens because we keep that door open for all those students. We don't know who's coming through, and they don't know what they have inside them either. So we really have to think about how do we galvanize our community partners so that we can get students coming through that door that are more prepared and more familiar with how it works at a college. We also need to continue to build inclusive and innovative environments for learning across the campus. Because as we know, learning doesn't take place only in the classroom, although that's a key place where we have to work on our technology in our learning environments, but also in the libraries and in the student soft spaces, in faculty and staff offices. Things are going on all the time. We need to make this a great place that has the facilities and the classrooms where we have the technology, the furniture, and the ability to support project-based and problem-based learning, group work, to really insert that of those concepts of information literacy across our curriculum, and really work with our students to develop those communication and critical thinking skills that are necessary for all the jobs in the 21st century. So, in the area of teaching and learning, I also see some opportunities to further promote our mission of access and success. We need to continue to improve our online schedule, as this is a critical tool to maintaining access. Many of our students have commitments that keep them from coming into the college. We need to be able to serve them in the best way possible. We need to further explore hybrid classes. This makes efficient use of our classroom spaces, but also helps students make that bridge from both classroom learning to online learning. We need to continue our efforts in mobile technologies. We started in the English department with some really good initiatives. Phil and Joe were meeting with Apple a couple weeks ago to talk about how do we bring mobile technologies to this college community. And I'm really excited this semester about working with the technology committee and really seeing them come back in and give us the feedback and vet the ideas and really help us find the best ways to bring these mobile technologies to the college. We need to expand our ability to use open educational resources again, this is a key to keeping the cost down. Students spend so much on the textbook, and there's so much available out there. How do we work closely with other universities that are developing open educational resources to keep that cost down? Now, we also have other areas where we've been very involved that we have to keep working on. Civic engagement is a critical one. Okay, how many voted in the primary today? Okay, all right, you all got your jobs, right? So, I was the first one in my district, 702. They were so happy to see somebody. It was great going into that middle school today. So, all right, but we've long embraced civic engagement, but this is a way to get our students connected to that world out there and really help them get excited about making a difference. We also have a long history of internationalization of the curriculum. And, you know, by having, a Fulbright scholar here for a year to work with our students, and the opportunities we have for our students to do fellowships and to travel overseas, we know that those are life-changing experiences, both when they go out and when we bring people in. So these are critical things that we need to keep working on. I believe there's an awful lot we can do with technology to improve almost everything we do. Data integration and data analytics are going to be key to making us more productive at all levels. We need to be more efficient and more effective if we're going to be able to reduce our costs to the students and really do more with less. You know, I like to say, no more bowling in the dark, right? Where we just don't know what's happening because we have no way to really look at and visualize that data that exists out there. Much of it's in our SIS system. We just don't have a way to pull it out in a useful way. Now, we recently were awarded a Title III grant that we wrote much of that into, $444,000 a year. Thank you. Four weeks, right, in 2015, and put that in. I'll never forget, we sat down for a meeting. We were talking about putting the grant together for next year, right, and got so excited about it, and she said, no, we can do it. I asked her, can your team do this? I asked about five times. They kept saying, no, we can do it. Again, that's a can-do spirit here. We put it in. It took us 2 years to get it, but we got that. That is great and will help us a lot. And we're still in the running for the Anapizi grant, right, for Asian-serving institutions. That would help us really reach out to our community here. So we're doing some great work in resource development there. Now, the leadership and management structure has also been undergoing some significant changes, and I've sent this out to the college. But really what we're doing is a lot of realignment and restructuring. We've been reducing positions, consolidating job responsibilities. We're really flattening the leadership structure at the college and creating a much more integrated team approach. It's really about being creative and about being entrepreneurial and about working together. So it's really, my goal is really to get the best out of people by putting them in the right place and working openly, honestly, and respectfully with them. So in closing, I want to say, yes, there are challenges. We're going to need to recognize those and face those. But we have huge opportunities here. And the Strategic Transformation Initiative is really about an open, transparent, and collaborative process where we can seize these opportunities and work together to build solutions. By recognizing the changing context that's out there and coming over us, by taking a hard look at the challenges we are facing, by having open and honest discussions and encouraging the sharing of ideas, we can come together around creative and entrepreneurial solutions. Now, working with professional consultants, we've created the case statement for strategic transformation that's been sent out in a is on everybody's chair. On September 1st, we met with the college leadership team and all the department chairs and all the program directors to work our way through this. This is a revised version based on their feedback. There's also a PowerPoint that many of the deans went over with their divisions recently. These are all going to be posted on a SharePoint site. I'm sorry, guys, SharePoint's so hard to use, though. It really, you know, we're working on that. And we are also going to encourage further college conversations. We want you to go through this and look at this and look at the SharePoint site and really digest some of this. Talk to your colleagues, right? Send in questions and suggestions, right? Talk about it in your department meetings. And we're going to get us all prepared so that on October 19th, for Professional Day, we'll have a fully organized day to really come up with some of the solutions. But the solutions are going to come from you, right? They're going to come up organically through all of us having an open and honest discussion. And out of Professional Day, I expect we'll get a lot of suggestions and a lot of material. I've asked the Strategic Planning Committee to then sift through all these and pull them together. They're going to work together with Cabinet to really come up with a draft plan by the beginning of December that we want to get out to you before you go home for the holidays. I want to be able to come back in January with knowing there are some things we can jump right into. We're not going to wait. We'll all have agreed this is something we need to go after right now. You know, you might call it the low-hanging fruit, but this is the stuff we can go do. We're not going to wait until we figure every last detail out. These are the things we can go after now. There's also things we can start process on. So we might decide, okay, we need to buy an analytics software tool. Okay, what do we have to do? We have to do our research. We have to do an RFP. We have to go through. But we can start on that in January, not waiting another year. And there are clearly going to be some things that we are going to have to study further and discuss more. Right? That's going to happen. This is not going to all be one shot. This is going to be ongoing for some time. But I am convinced and absolutely certain that we have both the will and the ability at this college to transform this college so that it will be stronger when we come out the other side of this. I've learned that this college is about great people. People who are committed to our mission, who deeply care about our students. I see that every day. And we care about our community because we are true educational professionals. As we move forward, remember to strengthen those relationships you have, to work together, to really know that the people next to you are the ones who are going to be your closest allies, your closest advisors, and the ones who tell you when you're wrong. We all need that. Right? That's an open and honest discussion. Those are what those good relationships are for. We will need to clearly define and stay focused on our core commitments. We will need to build consensus and be prepared to make the tough choices that need to be made. Through recognizing that student success and student retention, this is everyone's business. By recognizing that great ideas can come from anywhere, and by having the courage to take risks and be entrepreneurial, we will continue to build the legacy of this great college. Thank you. Questions? Comments? I'm waiting for somebody to come up here. Those are the anonymous ones. table today. This is a lot to think about. It's a lot to work our way through. I know it's not going to be easy. And we're really treading a line between being totally honest and not scaring everybody too much. You know? We really have to be careful about that. This place is not going to disappear or fall apart. Right? We're going to be here in 20 years. But what are we going to be? And that's what we need to decide. All right, hang on, I got one question here. All right, and then just preempted the chairman, right? I'll take that back. Mr. Gamble.
Jim, I just want to say that speaking for the board, that your call over much of what we talked about here today, we support that effort. It would have been much easier to say, well, let's just complain and wait and see what happens, but that is not the case. As Jim mentioned, there's a plan being developed. And I think the most important thing you can say is that sometimes out of adversity comes opportunity, and that's really the way we're looking at it. And we have a wonderful team, and I think I speak for Chief Hicks, as a member of the board, that we're fully praised with this and fully on board and understand that this plan can represent forward.
Thank you. What I want to say is, we don't have a plan yet. We have a planning process, right? We don't have the solutions. Now, that leads me to the question. This is from Gordon Curry. He says, much of the answers we are looking for and ways to meet the current challenges are right under our noses and with our own community. I couldn't agree more, right? But we have to bring them up together, right? And we have to agree that these are the challenges and these are the solutions. And he goes on to say, having been part of the strategic planning committee, what steps will be taken to have been taken to incorporate the feedback given from faculty, students, and staff to help in the strategic transformation process? I think that's a wonderful comment, and it will ask me to reach out to David and Jennifer as co-chairs of strategic planning to see exactly what feedback there we can incorporate into this process. I think it's a great solution from Gordon. As Jennifer and David know, I talked to them last year saying, I know we're going to have to go further with this planning process. I need the strategic planning committee to stay intact for at least another year to help us work through this. And we know they're going to be a valuable resource. But I think Gordon's really onto something. Those ideas are here. And those solutions, I'm convinced, lie within this community. We will look to the outside for many best practices, but we will adapt them to Middlesex Community College and make them work within our context. Yes, Sally.
I'd love the mic.
My name is Sally Boston. I'm a chemistry professor here at Middlesex and Lowell. I'm also the academic year 2016-2017 president of FSA. And I'm presently doing my doctorate in education, so a little bit we're doing together the work I've been doing. And my work is on service learning and the difference it makes for students' self-efficacy in their learning. And on my problem statement, I was looking at that in the present PCAS 212, you may be familiar with it, that we have 3 million students that register in STEM courses across the country every year, and 50% of them don't make it. So that means that's our future scientists and engineers. So 3 million, 1.5 million of our students still make in science and engineering. And in Middlesex, I think it's, Jennifer gave me the stats, I think it's 39% don't make it here at Middlesex. So, you know, I always keep thinking we need to increase the enrollment in STEM, but the truth is we need to keep what we have. You know, we don't need to go out and look for STEM students, we need to keep what we have, and we're not doing that. And I'll take responsibility on my part of it. And then the other thing, we just, with the Department of Higher Ed, approved that in community colleges that we are offering organic chemistry here this year, which is the second year of organic chemistry that's offered in the university and state. And we had to go, we aligned with all the chemistry professors throughout the state. It's been done in English and other areas. I just know chemistry. And we aligned on our curriculum. So now if a student comes to Middlesex and takes our general chemistry for engineering science and our organic chemistry for engineering science, which are the two major courses for chemistry majors and life science majors, they can transfer into any public state university in our state as a junior in their major. And they can do it at half the price for what they pay in the university. So students at Middlesex pay $1,000 a course for organic chemistry. They have to pay $2,500 for exactly the same course. I'm using the same textbook, the same curriculum, and it's $1,000 compared to $2,500. So I think one of the areas, I think two things, I think it's in the area of retention, and we've done things like SI, but I think that taking a really committed, organized effort to improve our retention in STEM. And then the other thing is expansion. I've had this idea for a year that we go out to the high schools and we bring students with us and staff, and we talk about our curriculum, that they can come here and get their first 2 years in science education at the Middlesex and graduate and be able to go as a junior and save half the price it would cost to go to the four-year school, and bring students with us. You know, students are our best advertisement. So that's just something that I think we can do, we could get organized around. I mean, I don't know what the numbers are. I mean, it's a huge thing, you know, but I appreciate what you said about being grassroots, and we just have to try things and see what works, and this is one of the things I saw.
Thank you. A couple of good points, sir. I think that, you know, as we're pointing out, retention is going to be key, not just in STEM, but in all areas across the college. There's a smaller high school cohort out there for the next 3 to 5 years. There are smaller numbers out there, so it's going to be incumbent upon us to keep our enrollment by the retention efforts. We're going to have to look into this very, very carefully and look and see what the best practices are out there, see what the best models are out there. If we, you know, I'm sure we can look around and see what's there and then figure out how do we do it. Now, some of the things are going to take, though, if we decide that this is the area we're going to focus, right now there's not a lot of extra funding for that. We may have to stop doing some things if we decide we're going to do that. But those are the tough decisions we're going to have to make together. We're going to have to figure that out. But that doesn't mean that say, oh, we don't have the money, we're not going to go do that. That's the wrong approach. It's say, okay, we have to decide what are we going to go after and what are we going to do here. And that's really a key. Thank you very much. Any other questions? I have a group today. Boy, that's a tough one. Yes, Chris, if you use a mic, please. So there's one behind you. Yeah. Right. So identify who you are.
Glad to do that. I'm Chris Brennan, Executive Director of the Career Place in Woolworth, and had four or five different positions here on campus over a number of years. I won't quote those number of years. Some people know. It's got a lot of enthusiasm. As you know from my recent conversation with you, Dr. Mabry, program development is a real interest of mine. We had a director of admissions many years ago, Debbie Regan, who some of you may remember. And she used to pop into my office and say, what do we have that we have as new offerings for the admissions staff to market? That people are looking for a particular program or a new program or what I call quicker, faster, sooner. And they don't want to come just for liberal arts or liberal studies. It could be career related or whatever. So just kind of a recommendation and a question about program development. I know through the Workforce Development Council that Phil has done quite a bit, Judy Burke has done quite a bit, I get the emails from the non-credit area of the new programs, and I see some of the other new programs, but if you look at the ITT situation, we give a lot of training vouchers, and a lot of people, I think they're oversold, but they're sold on these quicker, faster, sooner programs because they have a need for retraining. They've been dislocated by the globalization, and the other issues that are very interesting Fulbright Scholar is going to look at. I'd love to meet with him, but just a question and an emphasis on what we can do with program development. I think now that the career centers are reorganized under Judy Burke, I think we can even build that more as kind of a triangle of Judy and Phil and the career centers working together to help the college with program development to develop short-term options for people, both credit and non-credit.
Great, thank you. Couple thoughts on that. I like the quicker, better, faster, right? And when we're talking about scheduling options, I really have to think we need to think through that. The other concern I have, though, is when we work with our advisory boards, when we work with our employers, they tell us they need students who have the skills, but who also know how to communicate, work with customers, work in teams, all those skills you get sort of outside the skill-based stuff. I remember I was in an advisory board meeting with an executive from the internet service provider, GoDaddy.com, right? And they said, everybody we hire here in the US meets with customers. We need people who have communication and marketing skills, but also have the technology skills. Said programming, back office programming, you get that done in India, right? He said, we don't hire anybody who sits in a back room anymore. So it's interesting because employers are telling us they want students with skills that are fairly broad. Students only want to engage in this, right? They just want to, I'm not quite sure how to solve that dichotomy that's out there. Students want to go to ITT, get the technical skills, not take the gen ed, not get the communication skills. I'm not sure that's setting them up for long-term success. But ITT is a company that spent 62% of its budget on marketing and recruiting, right? And 90% of their dollars came from where? The federal government, you and I, okay? So, you know, I'm glad to see that doesn't take place anymore, because I think it's important to think through these. But it is a hard sell. You know, tell the students, you really need to know communications, math, statistics, and programming. Right? But just think about journalism, right? When we have, it's not journalism anymore, it's now new media, right? So journalists, remember Carla, who was our speaker, right? Right, she knows video skills, video editing, right? She knows a lot of computer skills, and she can write a lead sentence and stand in front of the camera, right? It's a whole package of skills today. It's not just sitting in a back room writing a news article. Very little of that. I also want to remind the viewers in Bedford that they can also submit their questions. There are people in the room can send them up to us. Okay? So we need some representation from Bedford. We'll put them on the spot now. Okay. Yes. David, yes. If you'll please use the microphone. I know we can hear you, but they can't hear you in Bedford, at least not quite.
You can hear me?
Absolutely.
So this is a question. It's also a reflection on what you all have been, what you have been saying today. And what we've been talking about and thinking about from the Strategic Planning Committee over the past year, and it came up at our division meeting. It came up in our meeting with the consultants, with the coordinators and chairs last week. And at some point, and I'm not talking only in terms of markets and market segmentation, there's all of that. But at some point, there is a reality in the community, not our community, our external community that we service, that we still have to confront, which is the stereotype about community colleges. And as our pool, as the demographic shifts, and we have a shrinking pool, we have to capture every part of that shrinking pool and be more creative. And that's what you've been saying today about how we do it, how we build on our strengths. But one of the things we do need to address front and center, and I know that I've been using the term, you know, rebranding. It's a common term, but the consultants used it. I mean, they did give us the example of IBM rebranding. It wasn't the best example. I thought it was a poor one, in fact, because when IBM rebrands, they invest millions and millions of dollars and figure it out. We don't have that ability. But we do have the ability to begin to deal with this issue about selling us more effectively, perhaps, as the first 2 years of the baccalaureate experience, instead of paying $50,000 a year or $25,000 a year at the public universities, you can come here for 2 years between $12,000 and $15,000. So that economic dimension of a top-notch the first 2 years of the baccalaureate experience being completed here for much less of the economic burden, I think that we do it, but we need to do it better and more creatively. And we need, because we still, when I have worked with my colleagues in admissions, in engaging with the high schools, guidance counselors still have this negative stereotype. And we're still presented with it. We still hear the stereotypes about community colleges in the community. I think that's a challenge for us.
Yes. And this is something we've been wrestling with for some time, and every community college wrestles with this, especially when you have a first-class university right next door to you. Is really looking at how do you market that to really good students out there, and parents who look at the community college as the right step rather than a step down. And we really do have to work more on doing that. I know when I go out and I talk about community colleges, I always talk about those students we see who really make huge transformations. The students that go on to, you know, lead companies, that get degrees from Ivy League institutions and all. That's a small number, but these are examples. It's part of that sort of personal branding campaign of my own, is saying, you can start here and go anywhere. And I tell students that. So at lunch on Tuesday, on the Bedford campus, I stopped and I commented with one young man, he had the coolest pair of red sneakers I ever saw. Red high tops, you know? And I told him he was really classing up the place, you know? And he came over and talked to me afterwards with a couple of his friends. They were from Lexington, which is not a big market of ours, right? And they were excited about being at the community college. But what I also thought was fascinating was they circled back and came to talk, you know, to me about it, and we try to find those ways we can bring those students in. And so when I'm out in those communities in different places, because I get the same thing, oh, you work at a community college, right? Okay, right, that, you know, this is not the most prestigious, you know, educational institution. But what I always do is overcome that with my passion for the mission. You know, this is what I love to do, right? I have a world-class PhD. This is what I love to do, because these students can go on and do that too. So how are we going to do that in a collective method? I think that really has to come up. I think that's a great suggestion. We'll keep working on that. And that'll be part of, maybe we come out of this with a rebranding campaign, right? Something along those lines, okay? All right, so I have a question here. Okay. So this was from Gene, right, asking about marketing in our prison. Can we do online offerings in the prisons? And I know we've tried to work in the prisons, but my understanding is that we cannot, they don't have internet access, right? So that we can't do online programs. Now, is it technically possible that they can lock down those? Yes, but they don't do it. I'm not sure if it's policy, state statute, or what in Massachusetts. But as I mentioned earlier, some states do it, but most states in the 1990s, when we went into the era of mass incarceration, got rid of that idea of real rehabilitation and just went for punishment. So many states have big programs in their prison systems. Right? Don't forget, I worked in a community college in New York. We had a foundation board member who would tell the story about being the first student to get a degree at this community college while in prison. He went on to Yale Law School, all right? And he says, I made mistakes, I ended up in prison, and I straightened out my life, and the first step was going to this community college, right? And he ended up a lawyer in New York City, but very loyal to the community college. But we don't have that ability to get most of the prisons. We've tried to work with the sheriff, Peter Katujan, and really try to develop some programs, but there are just all sorts of obstacles to us getting in there and working with them. Something we'll keep an eye on, though. And another one is, you know, if we have any changes in immigrant status after the election, are we prepared to market to this group of new immigrants, or people who move from undocumented to documented status, right? And I have to say that I'm not personally optimistic that's going to happen, no matter what the outcome of the election, right? I think that's sort of the political reality. It's a real stalemate in this country on that issue. But as we know, we have many students here who may be undocumented. That's not something we ask, but they cannot apply for aid. It is more expensive. They pay out-of-state fees and all. So it is difficult on that matter. They can't get federal aid or state aid, but they can get aid through our foundation. And that does happen sometimes. Now, not everybody agrees with that. You know, there's differences of opinion within our own community on that. But, you know, I think for the most part, we go out and try to serve everybody the best we can. And it is going to be an interesting election. We'll see. Going to be? I think it is. Okay. I was warning them earlier that I didn't, you know, they needed to put me on the teleprompter so I could go off script. That'd be dangerous. We have another question. Okay, we do. From Bedford. Okay. Okay. Okay, long apartment assist. I know we are still in the planning and discussion stages, but everyone needs to reassurance that as of now, there are not plans for job cuts or layoffs or cuts to some of our programs. Can you give us this assurance at this time? Yes, we don't have any plans like that, right? Can I guarantee we won't have to get to there? Absolutely not, right? I mean, I have to be honest about that. But I don't know where this is gonna go. I'm really, as they say, trying to put a good spin on some of this, but I'm hopeful that we will come up with more ways to increase enrollment and retention, which means we'll have to do less on the other side, less of the cutting, right? And I'm really hoping that we come up with those creative solutions, but we have not developed a plan for any reduction in force at this point, because honestly, I think we have, if we're going to do anything along those lines, we have to do that out in the open with everybody engaged in that discussion. And that's what I've said to my team right from the start, that if we're going to do this, it has to be done together. We're not going to do this in some back room. So we don't have anything on paper like that at all. And we have had long discussions, though, about that this is going to scare people, that this is going to worry people. But again, we have to put on our creative hats and really come up with the best ideas to move this place forward. It's, you know, the reality is there, but I think we can come up with ways to overcome this. Steve, please go to the microphone.
Hi, everyone. Steve Rossi, Center for Leadership Engagement. So, President Mabry, your plan relies on a very collegial campus culture. And in my experience over the past 3 years, we've run a very bureaucratic political campus, and I'm wondering if you have any ideas on how that culture shift might happen at all levels.
Right. Well, I think it has started to shift, and that I can say just this is part of the shift right here, right, is really engaging in a dialogue and being willing to stand up here and answer your questions and to be able to say we are going to do this together. It's about how I've restructured my senior leadership team and really said, we need to have this ongoing creative dialogue, that we're all talking to each other, that the doors are not closed, right? When I first got here, the fifth floor used to be quite quiet. Yes. Now it gets rowdy, right? There's a lot going on up there sometimes, you know? And it's really interesting. We've moved, you know, the academic deans up there, and we've got a lot more people talking to each other. And I think I've really worked hard at it to model that behavior personally by walking around and talking to people and engaging with people and listening to people at the campus. You don't change a culture overnight, but you have to start with yourself and start saying, it really is okay if I bring up a new idea, right? It really is okay if I ask a question. It really is okay if I ask a hard question, right? That's important. If I can't answer your question, that's my problem, not yours, right? It is my responsibility to be able to explain where we're going and why we're going, but I really want to do this all together. The culture will change by going through exercises like this together and people gradually realizing, oh, okay, I can speak up. Everything's okay, that's all right. And I give that message to my senior leadership team. I tell them, you have to listen, you have to be open, this is part of the process. So we're working on it, Steve. Another one from Bedford. Are we focusing our efforts on recruiting on middle-skilled job markets? One of the things I talk about, I get in this argument sometimes with elected officials when we're talking about vocational and technical education, right? So, and they start talking about plumbing. So I did a presentation last week at the Lowell plant here, and I said, we don't do plumbing. Right? That's not what we do. The vocational and technical high schools do a great job of that. But if you want to talk about vocational programs in the 21st century, talk about cybersecurity, talk about biotechnology. Right? Biotechnology, 5 semesters of biology, right? You've got 3 semesters of chemistry, you've got all. This is a tough program. It leads to a 2-year degree, and what's our placement rate? 100%, right? They all get jobs, but if you ask those students, are you going to go on for another degree? Every single one raises their hand, right? That entry-level job, that middle-skill job, that pays fairly well to start, but they will go on to get other degrees, and they will really support a growing industry. So our biotechnology students go into the pharmaceutical industry. We are the 3rd largest pharmaceutical industry in the United States after California and New Jersey. It's a rapidly growing sector in the Massachusetts economy. It's a key to our future. We are supplying those lab workers, those middle skill markets there. All right? That's vocational and technical education of the 21st century. It's a lot harder than a transfer degree, right? So that is a tough program. Cybersecurity, the same way. Don't forget, in Arizona, one of my department chairs, her son ended up living in the basement, right? And hadn't quite gotten his act together. He got into the networking program at the community college, and 2 years later, got his industry certification. His first job, he made more money than mom, right? She was a department chair there, tenured faculty member, been there quite a while. And it wasn't that she was paid low, he got a great job. I said, did you start charging a rent? She goes, no, I threw him out. So those are programs that are key. So we built that new cybersecurity lab down on Middle Street. The facilities and IT guys have been working very hard to get that together. Those are where we need to grow. We've revamped our engineering program, so it's very closely connected to UMass Lowell now. So we're really looking at those middle-skill jobs that there's a lot of opportunities. But those are tough programs. They take a lot of work and a lot of support. We have some very dedicated faculty in those areas. Okay. Other questions? Great, come on up.
Hi, my name is Sherry. I'm a civic engagement specialist in the Center for Leadership and Engagement. I wanted to follow up on David's comment about the stigma of being a community college student or staff person. I'm a proud graduate of Middlesex, like many people that work here. And also, when you visited the bank, you talked to, well, everybody's related to somebody that has gone to Middlesex.
That's just law.
Well, not exactly. It's pretty common everywhere you go in the community. So I wanted to ask about our alums. How do they fit into this picture of advocating for us when they vote? Obviously, they vote for people who handle the state budget. What are we doing to advocate and ask our alums to help us?
Okay, thank you. So, don't forget to get back to the alum for a second, but you reminded me when you talked about the work you do with students, particularly with our Paul Sullivan students, right? We've started to take them out to, we did this last year, to community events like North Suburban Chamber of Commerce, where the Lieutenant Governor was speaking, right? When they introduced us and our students there, Lieutenant Governor spun around, right? And when she got up on stage, she recognized our students and said how great it was to have community college students there. And she came over to the table and talked to them all afterwards. We've had Speaker Robert DeLeo call out our students when we were at another Chamber of Commerce event. So it's been great to take the students out. That's why we did it. We started this program to take our leadership students out and introduce them to people. I love taking them around the room. First they go, do you know what a Chamber of Commerce is? Now I go, no. So we start there. But I say, they've been taught how to introduce themselves, right? So I say, you introduce yourself, I'll do the rest of the talking. But they've met the governor, the lieutenant governor, speaker of the house, you know, chairman of Ways and Means, you know, they've been through, you know, all of these different elected officials. But the elected officials love to see our students. That's one way we've gotten more recognition, you know, for the college there. Well, with our alums, we've been working a lot on developing an alumni organization. So a week ago in our foundation board meeting, we passed bylaws for an alumni association. So we're starting a formal alumni association. And the foundation committed some extra funding to staffing to help us build this and other programs. So they made a commitment of up to $150,000 to help us build some of these programs. Once we have those alums, you're right, then we'll be able to really market to them and ask them to help us. You know, that is important. Probably all of us get regular communications from our alma mater, you know, asking us for support either financially or some issues that are out there. So that's something that Dennis and his group are working very hard on right now. We see that as a real untapped resource here. That's a great suggestion. Yes, oh, another one on the screen. Okay. Do we have plans to increase our marketing to older adults who need new skills to stay marketable? We're doing that all the time. And one of the things we're going to post online is our strategic marketing plan so people can see what we're actually doing there. But here's the recognition. When President Obama came out with his 2020 plan to say we need this many more college graduates by 2020, there was no way you could do that even if you every single kid in high school got a college degree, right? So that means you have to go to older adults. This is what we do and what most colleges do all the time. If you look at undergraduate education as a total in the United States right now, the percentage of students that are in a baccalaureate program, going full-time, live on campus, and don't work, it's somewhere between 12 and 15%. And they call that traditional students, right? So we are in a non-traditional world in that sense. As we see every day in our classrooms, there are students of all ages in there, and we recognize that within our marketing activities that we have to reach out through multiple channels. So we work in multiple mediums and through multiple ways. So everything from heavy use of social media channels, but also through more traditional means as well for our older adults. We are working with that as well. Okay. Other questions? Anything else coming in today? Oh, here we go. All right. With the need to change and grow with the challenges we face, how we work to further develop the skills of our staff and administrators so that all our employees are contributing at a high level and feel they are valued? Absolutely great question. Because one of the things that is key is the resources we have here and really making the most of those resources. When I talked about improving the institution's use of technology, that is going to require a lot of training. We know that we're looking at models of how do we get really support, IT support and technology support out of the back office and into your office. It's really a much more embedded model of help and support. And the way I describe it is we all find workarounds. We all have problems with our computers, and we work around with them for years and never call the help desk, right? But if they're right in your office, right, if they're there, you know, coming around to help you, you know, when you see them, you go, oh, could you help me with this? That's the model we need to have, is people out in the community, really, in our campuses, helping us in doing that. We're going to do more with train the trainer and really training people within departments. So we recognize that there's a lot we're going to do to develop the skills there. We also do have a fairly strong professional development program internally, and we do support a fair amount of professional development for people going out. Again, if we identify internal needs where we have need the skills, we are committed to building that within. We started to move away from the model of using contractors for this to try to internalize that and build up the skills. So we've reduced some of the IT contracts we had significantly because we felt we had the resources here. Well, we found we had the resources after meeting with everybody and talking to people and realizing how strong they are and how much they can do on their own. So we will always look to that. Will we always be able to do as much as we want? No, but there's certain places we are going to really have to think about investing in that. I think it's a great idea. Other questions? Anything else coming in from Bedford now? Okay, I think that we'll wrap it up at this point. It really was good to see everybody. I appreciate you taking the time and coming out. Appreciate your honesty and your questions. That has to continue. As Steve said, we've got to change the culture so it is open, so that we are all open and accessible, that we can have honest disagreements, right? We're not always going to agree, but we are all committed to the same thing. That doesn't mean I'm bad, you're bad. It's, you know, we're going to have to work through some of those disagreements, but we're not, you know, Congress and Senate, right? We're not committed to these ideological positions that are, we are here to get things done. We are an institution that does, you know, really come together and find the right solution. I mean, you know, Phil and I don't agree on everything. He's wrong most of the time. No, it's not, you know, I'm making a joke out of that. But really, we, you know, it's never going to be always the way I think it should be. But the important thing is, you know, somebody told me recently it's about building momentum, right? And you may think, oh, it needs to go that way. But if everybody's going this way, okay, you know, that's better. I'm much more open to that. And I always say, I want to come out with the best idea, not my idea. So we will move forward together, and we'll all make some compromises. We'll all work together, but we will all do this together. Thank you very much. We have some questions down below, so let's, in Bedford too. So let's